Got one from Jason in Overland Park, Kansas, and this came through our app, the Randy White Ministries app. I hope you'll download that from the App Store. If you haven't done so already, you can find the link at randywhiteministries.org. Just look up in the corner so you get the app. And the question is about E.W. Bullinger's books. Do you recommend E.W. Bullinger's book? In fact, specifically, his question is, what's your opinion of the books by E.W. Bullinger, in particular, his book, excuse me again, his book, Figures of Speech Used in the Bible? Well, E.W. Bullinger was a, Congregationalist, I believe, minister, and in the 1800s. And I think too many in today's world, either there's one of two cases with Bullinger. Either they don't even know who he is, or they know who he is and they're totally against him. And let's talk about those who are totally against him first before I answer your question, Jason. Those who are totally against him will talk about the Bullingerites, and they will categorically condemn E.W. Bullinger. And I think what they're doing is throwing out the baby with the bathwater. Bullinger had some ideas I disagree with, but I can't really think of anybody I totally agree with. He had some ideas even about the starting of the church. And he started the church much later than I do, the body of Christ. He didn't start it until after the entire book of Acts was done with. So some people call him a hyper-dispensationalist. I never met him, so I don't know how hyper he was, but that's the term they would use for him. Now, can Bullinger be wrong about some of his ideas on the start date of the body of Christ and still have a lot of good information? And the answer is yes. And in reading Bullinger, and I've read quite a bit of his work, I think that you find the man was absolutely brilliant. I think, and I could be mistaken on this, obviously, but from what I know, he was the best linguist that the modern church has produced. You know, if there are some others, they didn't write their stuff down and get it as known. He totally understood both the Hebrew and the Greek languages. And so he was a master at those translation issues. And if you got a tough, difficult Greek or Hebrew issue, and you can see what Bullinger has to say about it, it's valuable. And he does this without reading that theology in there. So why would you want to throw that out? Now, Bullinger is not an easy read for two reasons. One, he was a smart man. And two, he wrote over 100 years ago. And writing all those years ago, their sentence style was a little different. And back in the 1800s, they loved to abbreviate things. And so he's got lots of abbreviations that take some time to get through. But the book you let me just give the general answer here, and that is, do you recommend E.W. Bullinger's books? And I'd say yes, I do. Every one of them. I think you ought to read them. I think you ought to study them. Really had some great insight, and you'll have to put your big boy pants on to be able to, you know, read and comprehend what he has to say, but you will learn some stuff, and it'll be very helpful. Like any book that any human ever wrote, you ought to, use discernment and question the assumptions. I don't have a problem with that. But if you come back to me and say, look, he said this, and thus we should reject him, then I'm going to say, what else did he say? In that entire book, you pick one thing that's wrong. Just get you a black marker and mark that thing out and save the rest of them. We're all big enough that we can understand that the guy probably got some things wrong somewhere. But there's so much right in there that I think we can be a huge privilege. In fact, in some of my own books, I want to mark some things out because I disagree with myself. And I hope you mark some of those things out as well. That's just a sign of maturity when we can do some of these things. So the guy was brilliant. The guy was an exegetical genius. Yeah, I think you ought to read his books. His theology, it's absolutely just life-changing and amazing, really, is what it is. Now, specifically, you've mentioned, or Jason mentions his book, Figures of Speech Used in the Bible. And I've got the book here. Let me see if I can open it up here. Should have done this ahead of time. Here we go. Figures of Speech Used in the Bible. Let me get to the title page and give you the whole title. Figures of Speech Used in the Bible, Explained and Illustrated by E.W. Bullinger. Now, he's got, three divisions in this. And he goes through some things like ellipses. Ellipses is a figure of speech he talks about. He goes into a great deal. Absolute ellipses omission of words. An ellipses, when you skip something in the Bible, it assumes something in there. And he talks about these things, and he gives lots of examples. Leviticus chapter 4, verse 2. If a soul shall sin through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning the things which ought not to be done. It says here the verb shall sin supplies the noun sins. That is, concerning sins which ought to be done. The revised version, he says, evades the difficulty by a freer translation, but the correct supply of the ellipses enables us to retain the literal translation. Now, I just read that part to you to say, again, it's an advanced book. This is the one who's ready for some meat and can use these. Now, here's actually what I would recommend. Get the Companion Bible, E.W. Bullinger's Companion Bible, and use it alongside with Figures of Speech as you study a passage, and be prepared for a lot of time. Neither are easy to use, but if you come to be aware of these things, you'll be able to spot ellipses as a figure of speech in the Bible. And it's actually very helpful. Now, one of the things that we're just looking forward to in 2018 at Randy White Ministries is we're going to do actually a little series of small retreats of five or six people. And take the Companion Bible, E.W. Bullinger's Companion Bible, and just show how to use a Companion Bible. Because it is probably the most comprehensive exegetical study Bible there is. And by exegetical study Bible, I mean it's designed to help you exegete a passage of Scripture. Not like even I use the Scofield Bible. And the Scofield Bible is great for references. That's its biggest benefit. And then it has a limited number of notes, but they're guidance notes, not exegetical notes. The Companion Bible is much different. Every verse has the figures of speech and the Greek and the Hebrew and things that are there through all of that. And I just highly recommend.